Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In part one of this presentation, author Ted Holden explored the evidence for fundamental differences in our world's environment since a time when dinosaurs walked the Earth. In Holden's analysis, the most obvious explanation for the enormous size of the largest dinosaurs is that Earth's gravity was once considerably weaker. But the mysteries don't end there. While the Thunderbolts Project takes no position on these issues, in this episode, Holden continues his analysis and explores perhaps the most controversial question of all. Is it possible that dinosaurs existed on Earth far more recently than institutional science has ever considered?
Aside from the various problems I may have mentioned in that first interview, involving dinosaurs and flying creatures and things whose ability to function depends on something which involves a squared figure whereas weight is always proportional to volume, which is the cubed figure. In the case of size and strength, as you double your dimensions, you cut your power-to-weight ratio in half. You can only cut your power-to-weight ratio in half so many times still stand up and function, right? You've got a problem with the large dinosaurs, aside from just standing up, you've got a problem with what to do with their necks, right? Because as I mentioned previously, if they held their necks upwards, they wouldn't be able to get blood to their brains, right? I mean, it would take a heart bigger than their body would hold just to get blood pressure enough to function, right? So that you've got people nowadays trying to believe that all dinosaurs held their necks outwards, but a large dinosaur holding his neck outward would have an even bigger problem than that. In other words, something like a seismosaur, whose neck could easily be 50 feet long, right, could easily weigh 40, 50, 60,000 pounds. If you've got a neck which is even 40,000 pounds, and if the center of gravity of that neck is even 10 feet out from the shoulders, then you're looking at 400,000 foot-pounds of torque. And you're probably looking at more like a half a million, a bit more than half a million foot-pounds of torque for a number of these animals if they were to hold their necks outwards. Now, what exactly is like a half a million foot-pounds of torque ballpark for? Well, I mean, that's ballpark for the combined maximum torque of all four of the engines of an Iowa-class battleship. That is, enough torque to drive a 60,000-ton ship through the water at 33 knots. That's the dilemma. A sauropod dinosaur in our world would have no way to hold his neck. He couldn't hold his neck upwards because of the blood pressure problem, and he couldn't hold his neck outwards because of the torque problem. You've got a couple of other comments on that first video. Some of these I've seen over and over again. You've got a claim that, well, maybe the air was simply more dense in those days, or you had an atmosphere which was close to being buoyant, and maybe that accounted for some of these problems. The answer is not really. I mean, number one, you've still got to breathe that air, right? I mean, air which was close to being buoyant would simply burn up anything trying to breathe it. It would be like the redneck physics experiment where you get the guys trying to pour a pail of liquid oxygen onto a barbecue. That looks sort of like the napalm bomb scenes, you know, from Victory at Sea. And that's what would be going on inside the cells of your body if you were to sit there and try to breathe an atmosphere that was that thick. That's number one. Number two says that, like, even in the case of a 40-pound pterosaur, like the pterodactyl, the pteranodon. In the 1940s and 50s and 60s, that was the biggest flying dinosaur that anybody knew anything about, right? And they assumed that somewhere around 40 pounds was the largest creature that could possibly even glide, much less fly. They said even just holding his wings in a turn would snap the wing bones if he was any bigger than that. Just in a normal atmosphere, now if you make the atmosphere close to being buoyant, then that problem becomes worse, not better. You've got problems which I think would just eliminate this idea of a vastly thicker atmosphere straight off the bat. The only thing that really helps the situation is reduced gravity. You've also got a question of people wanting to talk about expanding Earth theories. And I mentioned that I do not believe in Earth expanding theories. Why not, right? Well, there's a couple of reasons. Why would anybody want to believe in an expanding Earth theory? There's two reasons. One is dinosaurs. You know, once you realize that a large dinosaur could not exist in our present gravity, then the simplest way to try to account for reduced gravity in ancient times would be to try to talk about the Earth simply expanding its mass, right? Well, maybe the Earth just was nowhere near as big in ancient times. You've got people making this claim, and they assume that you've got 65 million years to account for this increase in mass going from the world of the dinosaurs to our present age. It turns out that that's not really believable. It's like those 65 million years have gone away. Somewhere around 2006, you started getting soft tissue turning up in dinosaur remains. It started with this Mary Schweitzer at North Carolina State University, who was working with a bunch of tyrannosaur bones. They had one very large femur bone, which was intact. They cut it in half, right? They figured to glue it back together once they got it back to the university. But once they cut this thing in half, they were able to see that there was soft tissue remaining in this bone, that they've gotten more and more soft tissue starting from that time, not just in the one bone, right, but in a number of dinosaur remains involving hadrosaurs, involving like the triceratops, involving several other kinds of dinosaurs, right? And, you know, there's no way in the world that soft tissue is going to survive for 65 million years. Okay, they've actually started to get good radiocarbon dates for some of the soft tissue. In several cases, they've gotten radiocarbon dates of 20 to 40,000 years. So that you've got several data points like this. You've got radiocarbon datings for dinosaur remains. You've got good representations of known dinosaur types on canyon walls around North America. And the most common of the dinosaur petroglyphs is the stegosaur, which Native Americans called Mishipishu, which means water panther. You've got like a number of those which still exist. You've got a large animal that holds his legs underneath his body, which means that he's not a crocodile or anything like that, right? He's got dorsal spikes of the stegosaur. Now, Vine Deloria told me he'd been doing a compendium of Indian oral traditions. He'd been up and down the American continent speaking to every storyteller, every keeper of oral traditions, all the way from Alaska down to Tierra del Fuego, right? And he said if there was anything that sort of flummoxed him at first, it was the extent to which almost every one of these tribes retained oral traditions about, you know, Indian ancestors having to deal with dinosaurs. He said that the name Mishipishu means water panther. It's a name similar to the word Mississippi. The Indian oral traditions described this water panther, they call him a water panther, Mishipishu, as having like red fur, a cat-like face, a saw blade back, and a great spiked tail, which he used as a weapon. Okay, Lewis and Clark had said that their native guides were in mortal terror at the sight of these glyphs around the Mississippi River, because the original intention of these glyphs was caution. You know, one of these things lives here. What I believe to be the case, Stegosaur was not the largest dinosaur, but he still had gravity problems, right? It was like, I believe that the stegosaur moved into water after the change in gravity simply to deal with this increasing weight, but that he didn't have any real adaptation for living in water. He eventually died out. You know, the bull sharks got him or something else like that guy, you know. At the Kachina Bridge in Natural Bridges, Utah, you've got a sauropod glyph, which looks like this. But the evolutionists that are saying, well, this is just a snake, obviously, and these four legs are just smudges. No snake ever coiled himself into a configuration like that. That's a dinosaur.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.